はい、皆さんおはようございます。こんにちは。今ご紹介いただきました石倉陽子です。どうぞよろしくお願いいたします。今日はですね、サンさん、デジタルエボリューションウィーク2021の4日目で、How to Accelerate DX というタイトルで、デジタル担当大臣、台湾のデジタル担当大臣のオードリー・タンさんをお招きしています。私もとてもこれを楽しみにしてるんですけれども、オードリーさんについてはもう皆さんよくご存知だと思うので、このスライドで出てきてますが、まあ、今まで本当にいろんなことをされていて、今はそのデジタル担当大臣としていろんなことを進めていらっしゃるという感じですね。で、私は今一橋のなんとかとかって書いてありますが、実はフリーターで今どこの組織にも属していなくてですね、まあ、いろんなことをやってるというのが実情で、特に若い人に対してのいろんなことをやりたいなっていうか、やっていますっていうことなんで、今日はそのあたりも結構オードリーさんにいろいろ伺ってみようというふうに思っています。それではこの辺から英語でやりますので、英語の準備をしていただければと思います。Audrey, thank you very much for coming and taking time from your busy schedule. We really appreciate having you, and we have a lot of questions that we would like to ask. And if you could share your experiences, I think it'll be great. As a starter, I think DX. The Japanese government have been very much involved and encouraging DX, digital transformation. At the same time, I hear that a lot of companies in private sector is making DX as the big slogan, so to speak. And for the government, we have set up the new agency exclusively for digitalization, and we do have the minister in charge of it. And the private sector is doing a lot of things depending upon what kind of industry, what kind of companies they are. But at the same time, I'm a little bit concerned that we have been advocating this concept quite extensively, but when it comes to whether that is going to be implemented and that leads to the tangible output, I have a little bit of a concern because we are very good at advocating and proposing, and yet we are a little bit behind in terms of the implementation. So let me start off with the question of what are the critical elements to make the digital transformation produce the results and make it happen?
Certainly. Thank you, Yoko, for the question. My job as the digital minister is not the IT minister, and I often make this clarification to many Japanese media because they used to call me the IT daijin, right? And a difference is that IT connects machines and digital connects people. So the necessary critical element of digital transformation is not to confuse it with IT. If the work that you do brings people together, give voice to people who didn't have voice, make participation bidirectional, omnidirectional, multidirectional, rather than just people listening to one or two radio or TV stations and so on, increase the symmetry, the bit rate of participation and engagement, then you are on the right path of digitalization. Otherwise, if you connect everything, but still only one or two persons speak and everybody just listen, that's maybe digitization, but it's not digitalization. It's not truly digital.
Okay. I think one of the things that you mentioned, and I have heard I watched your video as well as read your book, and some of the things that seems to be missing, particularly in Japan, is that you talk about four pillars, and particularly these days, sustainability, innovation, and inclusion. And inclusion part is, as you mentioned, sharing. And just make sure that everybody is involved rather than one or two people is critical. And yet, that is not, I don't really see that clearly in Japan. How do you make sure that the inclusion is everybody's business?
This is a great question. in Taiwan, what we are doing is making sure that even people who are not of the voting age, younger than 18 years old, have full participation rights through digital platforms to initiate, for example, petitions that calls for banning plastic straws on bubble tea drinks. That started by a 16 years old. And when I asked her, why are you starting this movement? She's like, this is our civic class assignment. So the idea of inclusion begins with the basic education. And I think it also extends to lifelong education because we see the most active group on our participation platform are 16 and 17 year old and 60 and 70 years old. So the silver hair and the young people are the two natural groups that care more about sustainability, about future generations. So if you make sure that these two group of people are in natural partnership with one another, then you are off on a very good start in inclusion.
I see. You mentioned that the inclusion starts very early age, like at school, you know, 16-year-old girl. Mm-hmm. Talking about the straw, and but we, I mean, how is there any way that we can accelerate that? I mean, if it means that we really have to go, we have to work on the education in early stage, and it's going to take a little while for us to see the result of that inclusion. You know, the concept of inclusion to be instilled in the younger generation kids, for example. Is there any way that we can just kind of fast track?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I'm sure that in Japan, there's also plenty of very young people. Maybe they're just 14, maybe they're just 15, already starting very good social movements, social entrepreneurship, and so on. So in Taiwan, our fast track is just to invite these young people into the cabinet level youth advisory council. And this council, very interestingly, all appoints the people younger than 35, some of them in their 20s, but they are already quite well known online. And by calling them reverse mentors, advisor to the cabinet, they get this natural position that goes against the existing discrimination based on age, because instead of calling them young friends, we call them advisor, right? So actually the 16-year-old girl that started the petition is now 19 years old, and she is already advisor in the Committee of National Open Government Partnership, the National Action Plan Committee. And so I would call her the counselor. So Counselor Wang, and even though she's not technically speaking, a fully an adult yet.
A couple of questions. In order to make sure that the young people are placed in the, you know, given the position or the assigned to the position of making decisions, we need like a existing leadership group sort of changing their mindset or whatever, willing to make sure that you involve these people with new ideas. And I'm not really sure whether that's not that easy because they have vested interest and they may be, their reference point may be much more like, you know, with their experiences rather than today's digital native. So how can we convince or how can, do we need to convince these present, you know, sort of leaders of today or leaders of yesterday?
Yes, this is where the partnership with the silver-haired people begins to show its importance. For if the young people have the support of the 80 years old, like my grandma is 88 years old, then those elderly people can actually speak with authority about the necessity of including young people. One concrete example is that every year our office hires very young people, some of them like 18 years old, into our internship program. But initially, all they did is to help the government web services to work across browsers, because many older people, they're not that versed with keyboard or Internet Explorer, right? They're more versed with their phones or more natural ways of using tablets and so on, touchscreen. Right. But the government web services was not initially designed for that. Maybe they're designed for ActiveX or something like that. And so for the first couple of years, all the young interns did is to make our government website accessible, especially to the elderly people who rely more on touchscreen and speech interfaces. And that won the support of the elderly people, and the Korea Public Service and the leadership see the young people as someone who assists, not just criticizes. And that builds a very good intergenerational solidarity.
I see. I'm just getting off a little bit from the sort of the questions. Do you think that the COVID-19 accelerates that kind of trend? Because the reason why I asked that question is that because of COVID-19, we are not able to go to the office, or the senior people, quote unquote, have an opportunity because they can't really meet with their friends. I think they have an incentive and they're encouraged. And I think that some people, some elderly people, old people, are getting much more into internet because they want to keep in touch with the other people. And yeah, so that may be a very good factor, sort of a benefit of this COVID-19, even though that restricts our movement.
Yes, I think the transformation by necessity, as you mentioned, Yoko, is definitely the case. Actually, many elderly people that I met, especially people in senior leadership, they didn't want to teleconference or video conference, not because they cannot do it, but because they used to do that when they were young, and the technology was very bad at that time. So they remember how bad it was. Like, meeting face-to-face builds 1% trust, but a meeting online deducts 2% trust. And so because of that, they don't want to video conference. So the COVID-19 is a great way to clean the cache, like the browser cache in their mind, their stereotype about video conferencing. And they see nowadays with 5G, with Wi-Fi connection, with the anyone's smartphone, the cameras, and so on. Actually, it's very easy to set up, and it actually brings people closer rather than push people apart as they remember 10 years or 20 years ago. And so this new familiarity, I think, is a great opportunity.
I see. That's very encouraging. And I think that whatever, you know, the opportunity, we should be able to take an advantage of. Let me change the subject a little bit. We're talking about DX. What kind of world, what kind of society do you expect with the DX, if DX proceeds?
Yes, I think the digital transformation will make peace between the generations. We talked about people who are maybe two or three generations apart, but the digital world also shows us how the future generation will benefit or suffer from our actions. Too often, these are not visualized well. These are not communicated well. So people cause pollutions, climate change, disinformation that cause social upheaval without fully understanding the consequences. But if we give voice and build an internet of beings, then we can empower future generations who are not even yet born, but based on the environmental sensor data, based on the social measurements, and so on, we can have a full understanding of the consequences of our actions and therefore make much more longer term thinking, which was previously impossible. This is like how I experienced in virtual reality. I put on virtual reality for the first time in 2016 and saw the Earth from the International Space Station. And suddenly all the borders disappear. And when we are down there because of the cloud, we can't see other parts of the world very clearly, but on the space, we're much more holistic and we see the Earth as an interconnected whole. And this is essential if we are going to solve a structural issue like carbon dioxide that doesn't care about borders. Actually, the virus of the mind, disinformation, or the virus of the body, they are also cross-border. So to solve those cross-border issues require an intergenerational cross-border thinking, and that's what a digital transformation can bring us, like better telescopes.
I see. Great. Because I'm very crazy about the universe and space, and one of my favorite destination after this COVID-19 is to go to the International Space Station and stay there.
There you go.
How would you describe the Taiwan's position in the world with DX in the future, in like 3 years, 5 years out?
I think in 3 years, Taiwan will grow toward the sky, toward International Space Station. We grow by 2.5 centimeters a year. So in 3 years, that's what, 7.5 centimeters?
Yeah.
The reason we grow, and I guess it's relevant today, is because of earthquakes. In Taiwan, we understand how bad it could be for the earthquakes and the typhoons and the compound disasters. So our development strategy of digitalization is coupled with the idea of resilience. Resilience means that we build digitalization not to blindly develop one measure like GDP or whatever, but rather make sure that each corner of our society is well equipped with democratized tools to respond in time if there is an unforeseen earthquake or typhoon or COVID or things like that. So I think in 3 or 5 years' time, we'll be much more resilient compared to what we have now, because just as we learned in 2004 after SARS hit Taiwan in 2003, we installed this central epidemic command center that responds to new respiratory diseases. So we will build centers of excellence to respond to the emerging issues out of full digitalization, such as, for example, state-sponsored malicious hackers that has been actually all over the news over the past couple months. This is also something that we will build resilience toward.
I see. Very interesting. What would be your individual goal 3 years, 5 years out, or 10 years? Can you share it with us?
Sure. I plan to visit Japan after the COVID and meet you face to face.
You're welcome.
Yes. And maybe immerse myself in a new language. I really want to learn Nihongo. I currently don't speak the language, but I would really want to learn that. And beyond learning the language, I foresee that my job will take me toward more cultures around the world, because nowadays, for the past year or so, I wake up in meeting in one time zone, and throughout the day I move time zones, and by evening I meet with the European and African people, and so on. So this is like touring around the world in a virtual way, and this really builds a more transcultural mindset in me compared to the pre-COVID days. So I look forward to visit these cultures in real space once the COVID is over.
I see. Well, when it comes to the language, I hear you talked to the young people and from Tohoku. And we're in Japanese, so I know that you speak Japanese as well.
I was reading off a script, to be honest. But yes, I'm really meaning to learn it.
Okay, good. Okay. Just changing the subject a little bit, you have done tremendous things and accomplishments so far. If you are able to do it all over again, would you do something different, or would you sort of follow the same thing? You talked about the resilience and learning from SARS and all sorts of things. So
yes.
If you know what you know now.
Definitely. I will make a couple of changes. The first one is that I think we will make sure that the Open API initiative is rolled out even sooner, because we helped rolling out the Open Data initiative in 2012, 2013, and by 2014, I'm well integrated into the Open Data landscape in Taiwan, serving at the time of the Open Data Council in the National Development Council Committee. But however, what we are now seeing is that if we push Open API before Open Data, it actually lowers everybody's risk, Because if you push open data and a public servant needs to review it before publishing, it creates more work for them. It's more risk for them if things go wrong. And they get less trust from people if things go wrong. But if we push open API, meaning that data is published as soon as it's collected without human review or human intervention, then it saves their time. It builds trust. And when people criticize about the data quality or data pipeline, everybody can offer the solutions together. And no public servant would be saying, oh, this is a waste of time because it didn't spend time to begin with. So I would begin the automated API-based open data much sooner than before, than what we actually did in 2016. That's the first thing I will change. The second thing that I will change in my ways is to make sure that the public service holds the discussion themselves. Previously in 2012, 2013, we rely on the outside people to chair the committees of transformations and so on. But it turns out the career public service already know how to make such changes. It's just they weren't given the mandate, the authority. So we switched by 2016 into a one by one, like reverse mentorship relationship, where the young people, the outside experts reverse mentor a career public servant, but it's the career public servant that make the actual plans. And so this makes sure that they internalize the digital transformation instead of seeing these outside experts as contractors and so on. They have to see through this end-to-end process. So that's something we could have introduced in 2013 or 14, but we waited until 16 to introduce it. I will also begin that sooner.
I see. You mentioned the sort of the importance of trust in many aspects of this digital transformation data, and particularly so because we have so much information and some of them are not, you know, facts. And, and at the same time, I think we are not quite sure. It's not very clear to me whether the trust is, we do have trust, the amount of trust that we need to go on. And my question is that trust is very difficult to build. It takes time and you can lose it very, very quickly, but it does take a lot of time to build. Do you have any suggestions? I think right now we have a little bit of a government, you know, private sector and the people who may trust the media, who may not trust, and vaccination and all sorts of things. Any suggestions as to how to build the society where the trust, we talk about the importance of trust, but when it comes to how to build it, it's a it's a very challenging task.
Yes, our habit is to invite people who criticize into the decision-making process. So people who criticize actually care about this. Otherwise, they wouldn't bother criticizing. And my favorite question to ask is, if you are the digital minister, then what would you do? And if they have a good idea, I apologize very quickly. I'm okay apologizing. And I say, your idea will become national policy by next Thursday. Because we use the agile method. We deploy every Thursday. That's our sprint, our iteration. So anyone who can call the toll-free number, 1922, more than 2 million people called that number last year. They understand if they have a really good idea, chances are that the minister, me or Minister Chen Shizhong or the cabinet ministers will acknowledge their contribution, invite them into the decision-making process. And because they feel they are part of the solution, they wouldn't write off the trust. They can criticize about our incompetence, but once their idea become our policy, then of course the criticize become constructive criticism, then it's not about, you know, attacking each other, canceling each other's trust. So I think the two most important things, one is a very quick iteration. If they have to wait a year, of course, there's no trust anymore. And the second is this swift apology. If I did something wrong, I just apologize very quickly and say, next Thursday, your idea will become the policy.
This quick iteration is something that I don't quite see here. Mm-hmm. And I think that's key to digital world. And at the same time, to build the trust. And I'm not quite sure. I think things are changing to some extent. So I have a hope and I'm optimistic. But we tend to sort of postpone it, keep it off until we know what works or we have more information. And let's decide. I mean, we can think of quite a few examples right now. You know, we haven't made any decisions or we haven't done anything, even though we sort of know that's the direction that we're going. The quick iteration is not something that is something that you build, or you know, how did you make sure that does have take place, or has it been in Taiwan?
We need to institutionalize it. Mm-hmm. We are both democratic polities, so we already have an iteration, right? It's called mm-hmm. voting. It's just voting is very long. It has a very low bit rate. It's yes. 3 bits per person every 4 years, give or take a couple of bits. So the bit rate being so low, it makes people not care about everyday decision making or collective intelligence because they wouldn't think that their contribution, those 3 bits per 4 years, actually have such a good contribution to the society. So what we could do is to install new higher bandwidth types of technology. And I see democracy as a type of technology, social technology. So for example, the petition website, join.gov.tw, just like how Amazon will recommend you books to read based on the books you have read, based on the petition you have signed, the platform will suggest you other petitions that you might be interested in. Yeah. And so every day you can start a petition, join a petition, and so on, and increase the bit rate of contribution. And you can also, of course, criticize, offer alternate ideas to a petition, but we make sure that while you can comment on the contra panel, and you can support it on a four pro panel, these two panels cannot reply to each other. So people don't waste time to criticize and attack each other. They spend time on the issue at hand and upvoting or downvoting, but they do not waste time canceling each other off. So I call this pro-social media. So if we design the digital public infrastructure so it's pro-social, then it's fun, so people will participate. So the key to more participation is to make the response fast, make the response fair, and also make it fun. And if it's fast, fair, and fun, people spend more time on democracy. And with higher engagement, naturally, you get into a place where people feel shorter iteration is just fine, because that's what we are used to responding anyway.
I see. Very interesting. And I thought I was like, a reply button is not there. I think it's a very, very interesting and device that makes sure that, you know, you don't criticize each other, you go back and forth and back and forth, which seems to be getting anywhere. So, let me ask you, let me go back to this young generation sort of engagement. You have done this incredible job of engaging the younger generation. And in Japan, I think you talked a little bit about the last chapter of your book, which I read, and the Japanese young people, even though I really do count on them, because they are the ones who are going to create the future, and they're going to be around. I'm not going to be around, you know, 20 years from now, hopefully. But it seems like they are not as engaged, and I'm not really sure whether they are not interested or they don't feel that whatever they say makes a difference. And also they're not as engaged, particularly for the movement, as you did in Taiwan. And so what would I do? You know, what would I think rather than just, you know, criticizing the young generation don't have anything to say or whatever, you really need to make sure that you encourage them to participate and make sure, in a way, I do believe in do as I do rather than do as I say. So any suggestions as to the the older generation, or the sort of 30 years old or older?
Yes, speaking as a 30 something, just for another month or so, I turn 40 the next month. Speaking as a 30 something, I think this is a critical question, because the young people, they're digital native. They think in terms of the digital world. They think in terms of the open spaces online, and they don't actually feel that close to their neighbors unless their neighbors somehow makes them feel that their suggestions make sense. Otherwise, they're much more interested in influencing their community neighbors online, which feels much closer to them. So I think that idea of neighborhood, of community, really changes with the digital world. And I think the way to fix this is actually very simple. It is just to make sure that their immediate neighbors, people in the same township and so on, actually look for the guidance, the direction, the digital transformation from the young digital natives. So I always say to the youth advisors that you decide on the direction, and we provide the resources. And together we will form a vector. Right, they decide where to point, and we make sure that we go there. Right, and so the people who are young, they actually are. There's no shortage of new directions to go, because they are very well connected. They see the best practices or better practices in other corners in the world, and they are okay translating, introducing it to the people around them. So asking them to become, for example, social entrepreneurs while absorbing the risk of failure by the education facility. That's what the Taiwanese people do. We make sure that in their undergrad studies, they can use their startup as a undergrad capstone project, making sure that the initial investment capital, if they have to pivot, is absorbed by the education budget and things like that. So they can try quite a few new things using crowdfunding. And then if they fail spectacularly, which they probably will on the first couple of tries, they will write it up as field papers and also contribute to the sciences. So to make sure that there's no risk in failure, I encourage the young people to care more about their immediate neighborhood.
I see. What, I think you talked a little bit about the education and school and so forth. So what would the school and education system with the DX look like?
Yeah, I think the campus, the idea of the place where we learn together, is going to be like everywhere. The promise of digital transformation is that it frees us from the fixed structure, the physical structure that constrains the number of people who can listen to each other. On the online space, there's no such boundaries. So people, well, aside from time zones and the sleeping pattern, but other than that, there's no easy burden that's put on people's mind. If we say, let's just connect on video conference, you don't automatically think, oh, what about travel? What about commuting? What about bus schedule and things like that, which tend to complicate things when people need to meet with people they barely know. So the weak links can form strong links online much more easily and gradually too, rather than the immediate burdens that people think about in the physical world. And the same applies to educational institutions. Indeed, the whole city, the whole country, the whole world may be a campus, and their classmates, quote unquote, may be people in different sectors, in different age groups, in different disciplines, and so on, as long as they share a common value. So I think education in the future will concentrate on the common good, on the things that people consider important, regardless of their age or culture or place differences. And then the digital transformation will form a study group with people who care about the same value, rather than just happen to share the same neighborhood.
I see. So that opens up tremendous opportunities for them, for a lot of people to connect and do things together. I see. Collaborate. I think collaboration is one of the key things that you often mention, and sharing and so forth.
Yep.
Then the question is, what happens? I mean, I love to ask questions. What if? What if digitalization and digital things disappear one day?
So it means that it goes to quantum or something, right? So it's no longer digital. Okay. Right. Well, we have analog ministers and then digital minister. Maybe we'll have quantum ministers in a few years. Yeah, I think that the world is looking toward new ways of conversations, of communication. And these are the core human needs, be it the analog technologies of pen and paper, which are pretty good, by the way, or the digital technologies like the video conference we're having now, or maybe one day the quantum technologies of secure communication that cannot be eavesdrops, or direct links between the quantum states of our brains so that we can feel each other's emotions better and so on. I think the common hope is to link people together, as you said, to collaborate. And digital or the digital tools are just a phase, it's an instrument. Someday, maybe quantum or non-digital ways will replace this generation of tools.
I see. That'll be very interesting. I agree that digital is just a means. And yet, I think a lot of people tend to think that the digital is it, without thinking about what kind of society, what kind of things you would like to do. And that's something that we have to get away, because it's much easier to think about and measure, you know, if we are talking about how-tos or techniques or methods. But we really need to think about, okay, what kind of society, what kind of world we would like to create. How does the individual happiness fit in? We talk very often about this, you know, creating the common good and purpose. How does the individual sort of happiness fit in?
Yeah, it's a positive cycle, right? If I feel happy, I'm more able to share. And if I'm happy on average, even on the time where I'm unhappy, I'm motivated to write why I feel unhappy and what I did to make myself happier and share it with the world, right? So the more base happiness, the more sharing. And when the world shares these tips, these ideas, and so on, then it makes a supportive environment to make it easier for people to feel happy. So happiness, this joy, this fun feeds into this cycle. So I think the importance of individual happiness is not that you have to feel happy. It's just you need to mingle with the community that's on average happy. And then you can support the community and the community can support you.
I see. That's very good. And because we tend to think, you know, everything in terms of the conflict, this versus that, online, offline, digital versus so and so and so. But I think what you're saying is that it's much more comprehensive, and as we talked about, inclusive. And so that's the kind of thing that we're talking about, the individual or the society or the world. Let me change it, since we have about two more minutes. Let me talk a little bit about private, personal matters.
Sure.
You describe your day and the book in a very clear way. Okay, you walk through the place, you make coffee, you make ice and all sorts of things. What comes to your mind when you start the day?
Yes, when I wake up, I look at my surroundings and I write down, often with this stylus, the things that I learned in my sleep. Because I read material without passing judgment going into sleep. So I often wake up with a synthesis, with a new idea that brings those different things together. For example, you mentioned about this versus that, right? So I would sometimes go to sleep thinking about a comment that I read on actually Tyler Cowen's blog at one day, where a commentator says, so Audrey calls herself digital minister, but she also says she's non-binary. How can a digital minister be non-binary? Because we know digital world is a binary world. I would fall asleep with that. And I wake up and I write down my comments to that. And I actually did write that down. And I said, actually, digital is not binary. We have 10 digits. So it could be decimal, because digits means fingers. So a decimal is also digital. So in our mind, there can be more than one values. There could be 10 different values. This plurality is also digital. And so this is the kind of thing that I just wake up like with the inspiration, almost like a poem. And then I just write it down.
I see. I think that that is something that I found in your either your talk or in the book. I think that's by far the most important thing for me, because I think that, you know, while you sleep, you read all sorts of things before you go to sleep. And in the morning, you have like, you know, some key phrases or key concepts that transcends. And I think that's very true. And that was such, so I'm going to practice it. So we'll see whether that works or not. But anyway, so that was what it was. I think we're just running out of time.
Yep.
But thank you so much for such an inspiring and such an exciting talk. And I do appreciate it very much. And I hope that you will we will meet in person and you'll have a chance to visit Japan to meet with all sorts of people in real time. You know, real world.
Yes, in the analog and quantum world. Yes.
Thank
you for the very enjoyable conversation. Live long and prosper, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.
ということで、今回の、オードリー・タンさんとのセッションはこれで終わりました。とても面白かったと思うので、皆さんもいろいろ参考にしていただければいいかというふうに思います。ありがとうございました。